I must confess that Great is Thy Faithfulness is my favorite hymn because it describes what God has been in my life. A retired admiral is given the opportunity at the change of office ceremony to have a medley of music played by the Navy band. And the final song that was played as I was retiring after 27 years in the Navy, of course I joined when I was only three, was Great is Thy Faithfulness. And I cannot hear it without being stirred. I cannot hear it. Remember, once someone wanted Elisha to speak a word from the Lord, and he said, send for the musicians, send for the minstrels. And when I hear a piece so beautifully played, it stirs the anointing in me. So thank you so much for that. I thank Anthony Kent for his warm and generous words of introduction. I must confess that I do get a little nervous when people say, I am currently the chaplain of the United States Senate. I am sufficiently paranoid to begin to wonder, what do you know that I don't know? But praise God, it is an open-ended appointment. I've been there for 8 years representing my church, and the record is 25 years. I think if the committee that selected me had known that I am a vegan, they probably would not have taken the chance of bringing an Adventist in to an open-ended appointment for that long. That 25-year record may be in jeopardy. I am being instructed by the Holy Spirit to change the message that is in the bulletin, Attack Your Lack. And so I want to do what the Holy Spirit says to do. And so I'm going to talk to you as the Spirit empowers on the reviving power of God's Word. The reviving power of God's Word. And my thematic focus is simply this: harness the reviving power of God's Word. When we think about revival, we often think about some type of worship service, some type of outreach for the church. But revival comes in nuanced ways. When someone put a handbill in my mother's mailbox in the toxic pathology of the inner city of Baltimore, that anonymous Seventh-day Adventist did not realize that he or she was about to trigger a revival in my family. My mother already had three children, and as Anthony indicated, one in the oven. And the handbill stated that the opening message was, the day money will be thrown in the streets of Baltimore, Maryland, and no one will stop to pick it up. Now, my mother was on welfare. My father was once described by the musical group, The Temptations. I know none of you sanctified believers have ever heard of that group. But The Temptations used to sing about my father when they said, Papa was a rolling stone. Wherever he laid his hat was his home. So there was no paternal presence in the home. And my mother picked up that handbill and she said, I am going to that meeting. I'm not going to stay for the entire sermon. I simply want to know the answer to two questions: when and where. Right? When will the money be thrown? Where will it be thrown? Because I know one somebody who will stop to pick it up. My mother said, the devil is a liar. I will stop to pick it up. She went to the meeting, and I ran into Pastor Finley as we were coming in, and he and I have been involved in some preaching together, tag team type things, and he is an exciting evangelist, as you know. And you know how we put the bait out and we draw them in. And so for 12 weeks, my mother heard the Adventist message. Our blessed Lord said, "My sheep, hear my voice." And through the power of the Word of God, a family that had never had a male graduate from college, a family that had relatives steeped in alcoholism and other addictions, that family ended up with all of the children going through church school. My mother had two at Pine Forge and two at Oakwood University simultaneously. Okay? All of the children going to church school, all of the children becoming contributors to society. A literal overhaul of a family characterized by pathology because of the power of the Word of God. Amen. The Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing the dividing asunder of bone and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the human heart. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. We do not so much search the Word of God as the Word of God searches us. There is reviving power in the Word that we as a church need to harness and continue to harness. I was reading that there is a biblical illiteracy even among people of faith. When you throw out as ministers illustrations, sometimes you see puzzled looks on the faces of those who are listening, because many of our young people don't even know the Bible stories anymore. Billy Graham once said that Christians are one generation away from agnosticism. If we don't tell the story, if we don't harness the power, the reviving power of God's Word, we are going to create a generation that does not know the power of God and His mighty deeds and His mighty acts. Acts 13, 36, speaking of David, said, "And David, after he had fulfilled the purposes of God for his life in his generation, fell asleep and was laid to rest with his fathers." I believe that that is the mission statement for every person of faith, to fulfill the purposes of God for your life in your generation. And one of the best ways of doing that is to learn from the generation that has gone before you, to take the baton from that generation, and then to serve faithfully in every season of life. The springtime of a Christian should be prepossessing and exemplary, but so should also the summer and the autumn and the winter. The end of our lives should be like a golden sunset with its beautiful hues, serving the purposes of God for your generation. And a part of those of the service should involve passing the reviving power of the Word to the generation that is coming behind you. Don't take your secrets to the grave. Nourish the generation that is coming behind you, for we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. This word is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that we may be completely equipped for all good works. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. I love this book. This book saved my life. My mother gave my siblings and me our allowance based upon scriptural memorization. You did not get money in my home unless you could quote scripture. Okay? When you would enter my house, you would see my seven siblings and me searching the scriptures, not for spiritual nourishment, but for short verses. I know all of the short verses in the Bible. Luke 17, 32, remember Lot's wife. John 11, 35, Jesus wept. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16, rejoice evermore. 1 Thessalonians 5, 17, pray without ceasing. We pick the low-hanging fruit. I fell in love with the book of Proverbs because the verses are short. I memorized so many Proverbs, my mother put me on a flat rate. All right, no more, no more, no more. Sorry, okay? When I was 13 years of age, in the toxic pathology of the inner city, prostitutes on the corner, drug pushers on the corner, two of my running buddies, as we called them, came and said, Barry, we would like you to help us get back at someone. That morning, and something I've done for over 50 years now, I read the chapter of Proverbs every morning. There are 31 chapters in Proverbs. I ask what day of the week it is, and I read the chapter of Proverbs for what day of the month. I read the chapter of Proverbs for that day. If it's the 7th or the 8th or the 9th, that's the chapter that I read. And I've been doing that for over 50 years. That day I had read Proverbs 1:10. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not, as I had read through chapter 1 of Proverbs. So it was the first day of the month. And on the strength of the reviving power of the Word of God, I did not go along with my two friends. My two friends did not just get back at someone, they killed someone. Night after night on the evening news, their sad story was played out. One of the young men said, I didn't do it, he did it. But in the end, the judicial consequence was the same, life in prison. Had I been with them, even if I had stood and quoted scripture, I would have received the same penalty. It is mighty difficult to become the only Seventh-day Adventist chaplain of the United States Senate with murder on your resume. But my life was literally saved by the reviving power of the Word of God. We need to harness that power and continue to harness it. And probably one of the most beautiful chapters that celebrate it is the 119th Psalm. I believe when I began quoting it, that was when my mother put me on the flat rate. It is the longest chapter in Scripture, and it celebrates the Word of God. It tells us about the benefits of the Word. What benefits do we get as we harness the reviving power of the Word of God? The first benefit is the benefit of revelation. Verse 18 of the 119th Psalm, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. Hallelujah. Wondrous things from your law. We have such an advantage as a church with the revelatory knowledge we have received. There on Capitol Hill, it's amazing I teach a senator's Bible study once a week. Believe it or not, from both sides of the aisle, they come and I teach the Word of God. One of the senators, after listening to a briefing about how terrorists want to eviscerate major population centers, they're trying to get nuclear capability to eviscerate major population centers, he came up to me with a furrowed brow and he said, "Chaplain, do you believe God would permit humanity to destroy the planet?" I said, "Senator, are you familiar with the prophecy of Daniel 2? He said, "No, I'm not." I said, "Well, we will have that for the Bible study next week." Standing room only at the Bible study. As I unpacked Daniel 2, which involved revelatory knowledge, because Nebuchadnezzar discovered that his wise men, with their PowerPoint presentations, that's what it says in the Hebrew, with their PowerPoint presentations, I thought I'd show my seminary knowledge here, that they had been playing games with him. As long as he could remember the dream, they could come up with an explanation. And that is so typical of so many experts today. But revelatory knowledge is needed, because even the experts say, "We don't know what to do." Nebuchadnezzar said, "I can't remember the dream, and if you can't tell me the dream, I'm going to have you and your family slaughtered." And Daniel said, "Don't let the king be hasty. I believe we've got a connection. We've got a word for him." And as I started unpacking Daniel 2, with Babylon and Medo-Persia and Greece and Rome and the feet of iron mixed with clay, and I ended up, you know, good Adventist preacher has to end up with a little poetry. I said, "We're down in the feet of iron and clay, weak and divided, soon to pass away. What will the next great occasion be? Christ and his coming and eternity." I said, "Senators, before God will permit humankind to destroy the planet, he will put up the sign, closing time." The reviving, revelatory power of the Word of God. That's a marvelous benefit. "Open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law." And then there is the benefit of revival. We see that in verse 25 of the 119th Psalm. "My soul clings to the dust. Revive me according to your word." Praise God. Ezekiel was a preacher who was given the challenge by God of preaching a devotional message to a congregation of dry bones. Sometimes that's the way I feel when I'm preaching a devotional message. Ezekiel 37, verse 1 begins, "The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord into the midst of a valley that was full of bones. And lo, there were very many in the open valley, and they were very dry. And the Lord said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest." Verse 4, "And he said unto me," Ezekiel 37, "speak unto these dry bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord." There is reviving power in the word of the Lord. And if you want to shake the church with a revival, if you want to get dry bones in the church to come together, let's stop just preaching the newspaper. Let's just stop preaching theological niceties. We need to come with the fastball, you know. I'm a baseball fan, and Nolan Ryan was my favorite pitcher. And when he was in his prime, everybody knew what he was going to throw. They just couldn't hit it. He threw the fastball. You need to throw this. There's power in this. There is power in the word of God to revive dry bones. And we'll have the dry bones in your life come together and be vivified by the power of the Spirit. And then there's a third benefit found in verse 28 of 119th Psalm. My soul melts from heaviness. Strengthen me according to your word. The benefit of strength from the word. Stephen Farrar has a wonderful book called Finishing Strong. And in that book, he talks about how only 1 in 10 who begin their ministry end up at the end of their ministry finishing strong. And I thought to myself, what an amazing statistic. Could that possibly be? And I started thinking about the people in my seminary class at Andrews in 1970. And started thinking about the different people I knew. Farrar says there are two basic landmines, sexual indiscretion and money. And I started seeing how my class had been decimated and even more. And Farrar says there's one primary reason, as they did the study and questioned those who had moral lapses, the primary reason for moral lapse was the neglect of one's devotional life. I just didn't have time to get into the word and receive the strength that I could from the word. There's nothing like a word from the Lord to strengthen you. In 1 Kings chapter 19, Elijah was suicidal. Okay, I'm a doctorate in psychology. We call it suicidal ideations. Sister Jezebel had said, dead man running. Remember, he had fled, and she said, he's a dead man. And Elijah, who had done mighty things on Mount Carmel, was exhausted, worn out, burned out, and he needed strength. And it's beautiful how God handled that situation. He fed him and let him sleep. That's what some of you need. Seriously. Running all over the world and stuff like that. You wonder why you know, burnout, emotional distress. And God woke him up. The angel fed him again and let him sleep some more. Before he tried to correct his cognitive distortion. But Elijah needed more. Needed more than rest and food. He needed a word from the Lord. And that still small voice penetrated the fog. This man had burned himself out so much he had become a legend in his own mind. I'm the only vegetarian left in the kingdom. Even I only am left. Okay. How do you miss 7,000 saints? How do you become so wrapped up in that you miss 7,000 saints? He needed the strength of the word of God. And God gave him a renewed vision. And God gave him a renewed mission. And then God said, I know you asked me to take your life. You know, that we preachers, the suicidal ideations are sanctified. We say, you do it. You take me. Elizabeth, I'm coming to join you. You know, we do it that way, all right? Afraid to do it ourselves, obviously. God said, Elijah, I've got news for you. Although you asked me to take your life, my plan for you is that you never die. You're going to be one of the few people on the planet who appears in the Old and New Testament. You see, because my son is going to be on a mountain one day, as he sets his face like a flint toward Jerusalem, he's going to need somebody who knows what it is to tread the wine press all by himself. My son is going to be there. He's going to need some encouragement. And I want you, and I've got another tag team partner for you, Moses, to come down there and say, hang in there, Jesus. You can do this, Jesus. I want you to strengthen him with your testimony. There is strength and power in the Word of God. Finally, harness the reviving power of the Word of God by receiving the benefit of wisdom. I love how David puts it. He says in verse 99 of the 119th Psalm, I have more wisdom than all of my teachers, because I meditate upon your statutes. Praise God. I was preaching in Chesapeake, Virginia, and I had a home in Virginia Beach that I needed to sell. And it had been on the market for 9 months, and my real estate agent was absentee. I hadn't heard from him. So here I was driving back from Chesapeake and listening to a news program when the journalist said, this is the worst time probably in history to be trying to sell a house. And that's all the man of God needed to hear at that time. Worst time in history. A vagrant thought entered my mind. You are never going to sell that house. Now, I knew that was demonic. And I decided to take that thought captive, to cast down imaginations, to take that thought captive. And right there in that car, I said, that's a lie, devil. Philippians 4:19 says, my God shall supply all of my needs. Said it out loud, and I need to sell that house. And I hadn't heard from my real estate agent in 9 months. The next day, I got a call. I said, who is this? He said, this is Ron Gregory, your real estate agent. I said, Ron, I didn't even recognize your voice. It's been that long. He said, we got an offer on your house. He was very excited. I said, really? He told me the price. I said, and this is how much confidence the word gave me. I said, well, let me make a counter offer. He said, excuse me? He said, this is an offer. I said, let me make a counter offer. My wife was looking at me as if to say, you know, the marriage is in jeopardy if this thing goes down. I made a counter. I said, I want exactly what I asked for. I knew God was in this. Anytime you pray out loud the scriptures and the next day, God is in this. I want exactly what I'm asking for. I'll pay the closing cost. That was my counter offer. Next day, really, I don't know how you did it, boy. He said, but it is sold. Praise God. The wisdom to not let the devil intimidate you. The wisdom to know that there is power in praying the promises of God. When a child comes to you and says, but Dad, you promised. You've got to do what that kid says do. I had my son do that. My son came to me. I'd made the mistake of saying, son, any school you want to go to, college, that you pray about, I am committed. I promise I will support you in your effort. Praise the Lord. My wife was there and overheard me say it, unfortunately. So out of the mouth of two or three witnesses shall a thing be established. So he comes into me, full scholarships to three or four different schools, and he comes in and says, Dad, the Holy Spirit has impressed me to go to Yale. My first response was, the devil is a liar. $50,000 a year? Is there that? No, they don't give. They only give needs-based scholarships, and you know, and you make too much money. The devil is a lie. But Dad, you promised. And there was Brenda. That's right, darling. I was right there when you asked it. Thank you, honey. You know the marriage is in jeopardy. No, but anyway, you promised. And on the strength of my simple promise, that boy went to Yale and, praise God, graduated with a degree in molecular biophysics, whatever that is, and just graduated from the University of Michigan Medical School. So praise the Lord, with a full scholarship, by the way. So praise God for that. When I go to God, I have the wisdom. When I harness the reviving power of Scripture to say, but God, you promised. Come to Him with His promises. Tell Him you promised in Philippians 4, 6, and 7 that if I have no anxiety about anything but pray about everything, your peace that passes understanding will guard my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. You promised in Isaiah 54, 17 that no weapon formed against me will be able to prosper. You promised in Romans 8:28 that in everything you are working for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purposes. You promised in the 34th Psalm that the young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord will not lack any good thing. And in the 84th Psalm, verse 11, you promised no good thing will you withhold from those who walk uprightly. But moreover, you promised that I can find Jesus in this book, and to know Him is to have life eternal. John 17, verse 1, and Jesus lifted His eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify Thy Son, that Thy Son might also glorify Thee, as Thou hast given Him power to give to as many as would receive Him eternal life. And this is life eternal, verse 3 says, that they might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent. He said to the Pharisees in John 5:39, search the Scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And these are they which testify of me. Get in the Word. Only 10% of all people of faith ever read through the entire Word of God in their lifetime. Get in the Word. Even preachers don't. I can look at your devotional Bible and make a pretty good diagnosis of your level of spiritual fitness. Harness the reviving power of the Word, because Jesus is in the Word. In Genesis, He's Shiloh. In Exodus, He is the I Am. In Numbers, He's the star and scepter. In Deuteronomy, He is the rock. In Joshua, He is captain of the Lord's host. In Job, He is the redeemer. In Psalms, He is the great shepherd. I heard Isaiah call Him wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Micah said He is the one whose going forth of old is from everlasting to everlasting. Zechariah said He is the branch. Malachi said He is the messenger of the covenant. Matthew said Savior. Mark said Son of Man. Luke said the great physician. John said the Word made flesh. Philippians said at His name every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. 1 Thessalonians says He is the one who will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And Jude says He is able to keep me from falling and present me without fault, without blemish, before the presence of His glory with unspeakable ecstatic delight in triumphant joy and exultation. And John, exile on an island in the middle of the Aegean Sea, said, I was in the Spirit on a Saturday. I saw Him high and lifted up. He is Alpha. He is Omega. He is beginning. He is ending. He is King of Kings. He is Lord of Lords. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth bring forth a royal diadem and crown him. Crown him. Someone must crown him Lord of all. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your holy word. Thank you that it is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Thank you that we can use the force of your word, harnessing its reviving power, experiencing the benefit of revelation, of revival, of strength. Oh God, experiencing the power of your wisdom to guide us in these challenging times. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. I want to make an appeal to Seventh-day Adventist workers. As you look at your life, you realize that you have not been harnessing the reviving power of God's word. As you look at your life, you may even be willing to confess that a neglect of devotions, of a devotional emphasis because of your busyness, has caused you to yield to temptation. And today, you must confess that even though you are a worker, you have never read through God's 66 book love letter. And you're not going to make a commitment to do that for legalistic reasons, but because we are vivified by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And today you want to make a simple commitment. Barry, I've never read through the entire Bible. That's right, I've confessed it. But by the grace of God and the power of His Spirit, I am willing this day to make a commitment that some way, somehow, before I die, I am going to get through all 66 books. If you want to make that commitment, I want to have a special prayer for you, and I'm going to ask you to stand so that I can pray for you. If you're willing to make that commitment right now, I've never read through all 66 books, but by the grace and the power of God today, I'm going to make the commitment to do that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, what a beautiful sight to see scores of your workers making a commitment to take their devotional lives to the next level, making the commitment to get the word inside. Heavenly Father, without your power, without your inspiration, we cannot do this. But by your grace and by your power, we can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth us. And so seal the commitments of these dear ones to harness the reviving power of your word, getting through all 66 books in the matchless name of the Word made flesh, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen.